In this video, I'm going to introduce the idea of covector-covector pairs and show that these covector-covector pairs are, in fact, bilinear forms. And also, I'm going to be using some non-standard notation for the tensor product in this video. Most textbooks will write it like this, with the circle times operator in between. I'm going to omit that symbol and just write the covectors next to each other like this. So recall in the last video, I introduced a new perspective on linear maps. I said that linear maps can be written as linear combinations of vector-covector pairs like this. And this process of combining vectors and covectors together is called the tensor product, which your textbooks will write like this. So we have this new perspective, and this new perspective came along with a lot of benefits. The first and most obvious benefit is that we didn't have to remember the linear map transformation rules anymore. We actually get them for free. So if we write out a linear map in the old basis here, and we want to move to the new basis, all we have to do is we transform the basis vectors and the basis covectors individually. So basis vectors are covariant, so to build old basis vectors out of the new basis, we use the backward transform B. And basis covectors are contravariant, so we build the old out of the new using the forward transform F. And we just pull these out in front, and there we go. These are the components of the linear map in the new basis. So as long as we know how to transform basis vectors and basis covectors, we get the transformation rules for linear maps almost for free. Another big benefit is that when we have a linear map acting on a vector, we can get the correct matrix vector component multiplication formula for free. We just have to replace the linear map and the vector with their linear combinations expanded in some basis. And by using linearity rules and the Kronecker delta index cancellation rule, we automatically get the correct components for the output vector given by this multiplication formula here. And finally, the last benefit we get, I didn't actually mention in the previous video, but if we consider tensors as arrays, the tensor product will automatically give us the correct array shape. So what do I mean by that? Well, before I showed you that when we have a column vector on the left multiplied by a row vector on the right, we obviously get a matrix as the result. But there's another way of getting this same result, and that's sometimes shown using this circle times symbol in here. And what this circle times symbol is telling us to do is, it's telling us to take the array on the left and distribute it to each of the components inside the array on the right. So distribute, that just means we take this column vector here and give one copy of it to each element inside the second array here. And so we're left with this, which if you look at it, it's a row of columns, which basically, it's basically like a matrix. So this way of thinking tells us that linear maps are rows of columns. Now you might be thinking that this is kind of stupid. Obviously linear maps are matrices, you don't need anyone telling you that. And you're kind of right that this isn't a big surprise, but this idea of distributing arrays into each other will turn out to be very useful later on. So all of that is a summary of how our perspective change on linear maps gave us a bunch of benefits. Now next, we're going to go through a similar perspective change for bilinear forms, and this of course includes the metric tensor, and we're going to view bilinear forms as linear combinations of covector-covector pairs like this. So first of all, why are we choosing covector-covector pairs for bilinear forms? Why not choose something else like vector-vector pairs? Well, bilinear forms take two vector inputs, right? And since covectors take one vector input each, a pair of covectors would take two vector inputs. So that's sort of a hint that we're on the right track with covector-covector pairs. So we'll just go through the same process again. First off, we'll look at the transformation rules. If we assume we can write out any bilinear form as a linear combination of covector-covector pairs to get the transformation rule for these components, we just transform the basis covectors individually. So basis covectors are contravariant, so to build old from the new, we use the forward transform F, and putting these in front gives us this transformation rule, which as we can see is the correct one. And we could go through a similar process for the reverse transformation. Next, we can see that we can also get the correct component multiplication formula when a bilinear form acts on two vector inputs. So again, all we do is replace the bilinear form and the vectors with their linear combination expansions in some basis. And what we do now is we pass each of these vector inputs to their corresponding covectors. So the first vector is passed to the first covector, and the second vector is passed to the second covector. And by linearity of covectors, these come out in front. And these become Kronecker deltas. And finally, by the index cancellation rules, we get this. And this is the correct component multiplication formula that ends up giving us a single number as the result. And finally, the last benefit is the array shape. So with linear maps, we had this circle times operation with a column vector on the left and a row vector on the right. But for bilinear forms, since we're dealing with covector-covector pairs, we're going to use two row vectors instead. And again, we're going to distribute the array on the left to every element of the array on the right. And we end up with this, which is basically a row of rows. Okay, so hold on, we got a row of rows, and that might not seem right at first. Recall in a previous video, I wrote out the array multiplication like this, where this bilinear form, or metric tensor, was a matrix. So why did we get a row of rows? Well, a row of rows actually makes a lot more sense. Remember, with this formula up here, even though we have two vector inputs, we needed to write one as a column and one as a row flipped on its side to make the multiplication work correctly. And that's kind of weird, because vectors should never be written as rows, they should always be written as columns, right? Well, when we write the bilinear form as a row of rows, the matrix multiplication formula makes a lot more sense. We can write out both vectors as columns. And you'll see that if we churn through this, we get the right answer. So here's a row and a column. We just multiply them together like we normally would. We do first times first plus second times second. And now we have a sum of two rows here, so I'll just add them together. And again, we have a row and a column here, so it's the same old process, first times first plus second times second. And the final result is this, which we could write as this summation. So from an array multiplication standpoint, viewing the bilinear form as a row of rows actually makes a lot of sense. So to summarize what we learned in this video, we learned that we can write bilinear forms as linear combinations of covector-covector pairs, and this immediately gives us the transformation rules, the component multiplication formula, and the correct array shape, all for free.